Recently, some pretty strange solar tech has caught my eye. And before you lies three new contraptions for every kind of conjurer. A coating that could someday transform objects into miniature solar panels, a memory alloy that can shift panels into different shapes, and a dye that can transmute a solar panel into, well, a better performing solar panel. Every little bit counts. And these concepts might not translate into usable tech for a while. But as solar's deployment and commercialization continues to rapidly progress, it's still fun to take a moment and stop and stare at the weird little things that scientists are discovering all along the way. They may lead to some interesting developments down the road. So, what's the story behind these experiments, and can anything practical actually come out of them? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Incogni. Ever watched a chemistry demonstration and thought of ancient alchemy, or spotted a tech expo showstopper and wondered if it would have been called sorcery at some point? Well, the line between science and magic can blur, especially when new tech looks downright bizarre. But for lab researchers, it's just another day at work. I had to dive deeper into these developments because, well, you'll see. Perovskite's come up a lot on this channel, and for good reason. They're powerful, hitting lab efficiencies of 25%, which is a bit higher than what we typically see in a commercial silicon solar cell. But they're still improving. But it's not just about efficiency. Perovskites are thin, flexible, and versatile, enabling some groundbreaking use cases. Researchers at Oxford University's physics department developed an ultra-thin perovskite coating, just over a micron thick, nearly 150 times thinner than a silicon wafer. Usually making cells this thin reduces efficiency to around 7 to 18%, but Oxford tackled this with multi-junction cells, stacking layers to capture more of the light spectrum and boost efficiency. Think of it like layering a bunch of complementary solar cells all tuned to different wavelengths of light. Working together, they can capture more of the light spectrum and thereby get more juice out of a given amount of sunlight. Oxford's new flexible perovskites hit 27% efficiency in lab conditions, which has been verified by Japan's National Institute of Advanced Industrial Science and Technology. And this could just be the start. Shuifang Hu from the Oxford team noted that the device jumped from an efficiency of 6% to 27% in just 5 years, suggesting future iterations could exceed 45% with further multi-junction tweaks. That would be incredible, if they can pull it off. Now, this is all very well and good, but it's also not that strange, right? I mean, perovskites have been known to outperform silicon for a while, and while a 45% efficiency could be a game changer, it's still just a could. So let's get a little weird. Now, the Oxford team believes this ultra-thin coating could turn everyday objects into solar panels. As team member Junka Wong puts it, "We can envisage perovskite coatings being applied to broader types of surface to generate cheap solar power, such as the roof of cars and buildings and even the backs of mobile phones. If more solar energy can be generated in this way, we can foresee less need in the longer term to use silicon panels or build more and more solar farms." And the cost of solar energy has fallen by over 80% between 2010 and 2021. As manufacturing technology gets better and solar gets more popular, it's going to keep going down. And for right now, and for the foreseeable future, the most expensive part of building a solar farm is buying the vast tracts of land for all your PV modules. The Oxford team theorizes that using their perovskites to make PVs more efficient in more places could help reduce the massive land requirements. And the Oxford team suggests that their tech could have a big impact on everything from utilities and construction to car manufacturing. Now let's do some interdimensional travel. Oftentimes, solar cell stats reflect what's possible under ideal conditions. Direct sunlight, perfect temperatures, and pristine lab settings. But in the real world, especially at home, PVs face clouds, trees, dust, snow, and way more blocking their light. So how can we get the most out of our solar cells when they're in less than ideal conditions? Well, scientists from the Korea Electrotechnology Research Institute, or KERI, have a proposal. This. Now, despite appearances, this is not a Lee Marchand box or something from Hellraiser, but it's just about as weird. This is the latest three-dimensional shape-changing PV module. Of course, most solar panels exist in three dimensions already, but 3D modules like this are designed to collect solar energy from multiple directions rather than just one, or two in the case of bifacial solar panels. So how do PVs collect more light in less than ideal conditions? So let's revisit our real-world scenario. The sun and Earth are constantly moving, so optimizing solar panel alignment is key. In the northern hemisphere, that usually means pointing your panels south. But what if a tree, or hill, or a large billboard blocks the way? Or maybe your house lacks enough south-facing roof space. I've run into that problem myself. There are a few workarounds, but they're not perfect. You could add more panels in less than ideal spots or use solar tracking devices to maximize sunlight capture. However, both options drive up the costs. And that brings us back to the 3D solar modules Carrie is developing. With their multidimensional structure, these modules capture light from multiple directions, maximizing energy in less than ideal conditions. It's like the brute force approach of adding more panels on a rooftop, but with a slight twist. And before we get into more of that twist, there's another tool that I've been using that helps with another less than ideal condition. That's protecting your online privacy with today's sponsor, Incogni. As my wife and I were getting our house constructed, setting up loans and getting insurance and everything else that you have to do when you're moving, I saw a major uptick in the amount of spam promotional emails I was getting. I'm sure you've experienced this kind of thing too. That happened because companies sold my information to data brokers. Sometimes they sell your info to some pretty shady people, or they can fall victim to data breaches that leak your data to scammers. Incogni can help you with this. We have the right to request that data brokers delete our information, but it takes a lot of time and effort. I signed up for Incogni and gave them the legal right to work on my behalf and then just sat back and relaxed. You'll see updates in your account for which data brokers they've sent legal requests to and which ones have complied. It couldn't be easier. Incogni really has been helping me. If you want to take back some of the control around who has access to your personal information, give Incogni a try. Take your personal data back with Incogni. Use code UNDECIDED at the link below and get 60% off an annual plan. Thanks to Incogni and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to Carrie's interesting twist on solar. Well, Carrie's earlier design used semi-flexible PVs made of triangles attached to a metal textile that folds like origami, allowing deployment in unconventional spots like benches, awnings, or even telephone poles. Building on this, researchers developed a memory alloy that lets the PVs follow the sun without motors, shifting into 3D shapes to capture light from all angles. Now, it's no Optimus Prime, but it's a clever transformer, boosting efficiency by 60% compared to flat, stationary PV facing south all day. Now, Carrie doesn't compare their device to other sun trackers, so they're putting themselves in the best light. Pun intended. But unlike motorized trackers, Carrie's PVs avoid those additional failure points. Still not strange enough for you? Well, now Carrie's latest study, Electric Power from Shadows and Indoors, Solar Cells Under Diffuse Light Conditions, explores how much diffuse light exists in urban and indoor environments, bouncing off of clouds, shiny buildings, cars, and indoor surfaces like walls and tables. This is a very theory-heavy paper, but the author's findings point out that there's a lot more diffuse light in urban and indoor conditions than you might first expect. To start, there's the diffuse light coming through clouds. It's reflecting off of the shiny glass, steel, and polished stone exteriors of nearby buildings. It's ricocheting off passing cars. Then there's all sorts of electric lights in cities. And all that light is bouncing off of various surfaces and doors like tables and walls. Although the study focuses on 2D PVs, Carrie suggests that a 3D module will be the next step. If light's coming in from every odd angle, a shape-changing 3D PV could make the most of it. Now, while I am always skeptical of studies that pitch their own device as the solution, if Carrie's tech does check out, it could pave the way for PVs that work well in less than ideal conditions. And speaking of checking something out, check to see if you're still subscribed to my channel. I've been getting a lot of messages from folks that thought they were subscribed, but actually aren't. If you think I've earned it, subscribing and hitting the notification bell not only helps to make sure you don't miss a video, but it also helps with the almighty YouTube algorithm. Anyway, on to the next one. Flexibility is great, but how about a solar cell with a little ink? Not a tattoo, but a dye that concentrates more light into the solar cell. That's what researchers from the Silesian University of Technology in Poland have cooked up. These dye concentrator cells are similar to dye sensitized cells, or DSSCs, but with a key difference. Typically, solar panels work by exposing silicon to sunlight, knocking electrons and holes loose. If we can capture those before they settle, we get a usable electrical current. Think about it like a game of billiards. Imagine the cue ball is the sunlight, and the rest of the table are electrons and holes. The cue ball hits the rack, sends those solids and stripes flying, and if we're skilled enough, or just lucky, we'll sink a few into the pockets and score some points. In other words, a usable electrical current. Now, DSSCs use photosensitive dye instead of silicon, making it easier to free up electrons because the dye is more light sensitive. Now, the semiconducting layer, usually titanium dioxide, helps keep those electrons moving. Using dye is like playing billiards with a lighter snooker set. If your photon break shot connects with the rack, the lighter weight is going to make it easier to get more movement, so you're more likely to sink something into one of the pockets and score. While DSSCs focus on electrons, dye concentrators work on photons. They act like lenses, focusing light more effectively onto the cell surface, making it easier to capture light from all angles. It's like putting a funnel on a billiards table, which is not recommended to bars, but it guides the ball right into the pocket. Now in the study, red dye boosted power generation by 1.21% on average. And that might not sound like much, but every point counts. Dye concentrators are also easier to make than DSSCs, which require complex manufacturing, and they don't scale very easily. Concentrators just focus on their one job. As the researchers explained, these dyes are utilized as elements that concentrate solar radiation onto a silicon cell. They do not generate electricity themselves, and thus do not need to undergo a series of chemical reactions, exhibit properties enabling connection to the conductor surface, or possess redox properties. Because concentrators don't need direct sunlight, they're great for areas with dispersed light, like cloudy Central Europe. Even in regions with frequent clouds, UV rays are still abundant, and dye concentrators help capture that diffuse light, which opens up more opportunities for less than ideal conditions. The benefits don't stop at cloudy skies. Even at 1,000 watts per square meter, which is the irradiance on a typical sunny day, the efficiency boosts range from 0.1% to 1.1% depending on the dye type, color, and temperature. However, not all variables showed improvement. I mean, four configurations decreased efficiency under low light, which is about 200 watts per square meter. Still, the luminescent red dye consistently boosted performance, peaking at a 1.21% increase, a solid reason to paint the town red. Now, the Salesian team hopes dye concentrators will make solar panels more efficient, reducing the need for more panels and cutting down on PV waste. Silicon may be abundant, but with up to 40% material loss during wafer production, any reduction is worthwhile. So how close are these technologies to hitting the market? The truth is that they're really early stages of development, with plenty of hurdles to clear before they can even get close to commercialization. So don't expect to see them anytime soon, but that doesn't make them any less exciting. These innovations are building blocks for something potentially revolutionary. The Kerry team describes their 3D solar design as a concept car, a prototype that challenges existing norms, but isn't meant to go straight to production. They believe their core ideas could inspire next-gen products, even if they don't hit the market exactly as they appear now. Given the complexity, that approach does make sense. In a similar fashion, the Salesian University researchers acknowledge that while their dye concentrators have clear potential, several key aspects remain in the research phase. They're working out optimizing placement, adjusting the ratio of concentrators to PV components, and developing dyes that are stable, durable, eco-friendly, and affordable to produce. You know, simple stuff. They also note that replacing part of the PV cell with a concentrator can reduce overall efficiency, making them best suited for diffuse light conditions or large-scale PV systems where the benefits outweigh the downsides. As for Oxford's perovskite research, there's still no clear answer to the material's infamous stability issues. However, Oxford PV, a spin-off from the university, claims its tandem cells will meet or exceed all industry lifetime expectations, and have already begun large-scale manufacturing of these perovskite on silicon cells in their German factory, which is the first of its kind in the world. Now, Oxford PV just launched its perovskite tandem modules commercially, and while we can't confirm if they're sharing insights with the research team, wouldn't be surprising. Now, before we get too carried away, let me bring us all back down to Earth for a moment and reiterate that as exciting as these weird pieces of PV tech are, they're still in early development. There's no way of telling if or when we'll see these things in the wild. The road to commercialization is littered with seemingly rock-solid pieces of tech that never quite make it. I hope these weird, wonderful PV phenomena can navigate it successfully, because if they do, that means more solar energy. And the more solar, the better. But what do you think? Which of these areas of research catches your eye? Jump in the comments and let me know, and be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll keep this conversation going. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support. Your help really helps keep this channel going. I'll see you in the next one.